Excellent. So, hi, Chris. So, thanks for this invitation. It's really nice. So, my name is Patrick Smakia, and as you can hear, I'm French. And I had the chance to start a .NET developer tool more than 15 years ago. It was in 2004, which tool is named EndiPen. So the idea for the tool was that at this point, I was consulting a lot, large company, large bank, large automation company, large guys like that. And the recurring pattern I saw was that these guys, they had a legacy, a big .NET code, or very big legacy, with a lot of developers, a lot of turnover. And the thing is that nobody really knew the history. It was a big pain to really understand the legacy, what has been done, what you should do to maintain it, the quality, the dependency, the architecture. So it was a problem. So the initial idea of EndiPen was a tool to scan log your legacy, or to scan you if you want to live in Greenfield, you to scan your new code base, and to gather a lot of information that are hidden inside the code itself. That was the idea.
Yeah, that actually that you know that's that makes a lot of sense because you walk into many new jobs and very little in your career do you actually go and hit file new project, which is what all the documentation says to do and everybody's demos do. But then you go to work for real and there's years of code.
Yes,
So
of
being
course.
able to navigate that is that sounds real interesting.
Multiplied by the number of developer.
Oh yep,
Years
plus
multiplied
the
by
number of
number of
developers
developer.
who
So that's
plus the number of developers who aren't there anymore.
yes, exactly. And that's oh yes. So yeah, I like to consider that the code I used to write like years ago, it was like if it's another one, you don't try to remember too much. Especially because you have toolings that avoid to that lets you get the information you want exactly at the right time. So if you want, so I will do a lot of demonstration
Yeah, cool.
during the, I think it's much better since we are this is a screencast. So I would like to demonstrate something fun. For example, imagine such large legacy is let's say .NET 5 framework. So this is Visual EndiPen, which is EndiPen outside Visual Studio. So EndiPen can be inside Visual Studio, or also as a standalone, or also into your continuous integration process, whether you have Azure DevOps or Jenkins, SteamCity, or whatever. So let's use that because it's a very large code base, and I didn't download the source code. So I'm gonna analyze some .NET assemblies, and I know that those ones. So all .NET Framework 5 is in this folder, right? So I just put this folder, so it finds all our good friends, MS Core Lib, and system.everything, okay? So I want to analyze the 106.4.NET assemblies. Okay, so at that point, I'm not building a report. So let's go. So hopefully it should be pretty fast. So EndiPen is quite a fast tool even on very large application. So let's have a look at what can it says about something as big and as the entire .NET framework itself. I think we can consider it as a big legacy. So one interesting thing is that the source of analysis here are assemblies. But for your application, it can be assemblies, and if you are compiling in debug mode, then you have the PDB file. Then from PDB, it can go back to source file. Also from the Visual Studio solutions and projects you have, you can also infer the projects and assemblies to analyze. So basically, you can throw any input you want that define your legacy. And it will be able to analyze it. So here it's analyzing, so it's passing a lot of rules. Okay, and so it takes a bit of time because it's a very large system. So we have almost 18,000 types in the entire, not just public types, but also internal and private everything. So here we have the dashboard, the tool, and you can click pretty much everything you want. Okay, and when you click, basically you see exactly what you're clicking. So even the number of methods, so there is 200K methods almost. That's a very, very big code base, okay? So here, all the rules have been passed, because so there is a rule system, okay? So here there is a dashboard. So it infer like 100,000 issues.
Yeah.
Directly from the assemblies themselves, okay?
Okay.
And for example, we can group this issue by rules. Okay, and so for example, here we can see there are many public methods that are actually internal. So it advises to make them internal. Or here there are architecture problems about namespace mutually dependent. Okay, so basically the assemblies are not layered. Okay, so there are many rules. So I think we'll go in detail with the rule. What I want to show you, something that speaks a lot, is the dependency graph of the entire .NET. So that's pretty interesting to get that. So first, you can see that NDPN is introducing some what we call some kind of cluster. You can remove, for example, the cluster. But if you remove the cluster, it's not so well. It's not very well interesting here. Okay, so better go back with cluster. Okay, you can expand, you can go to namespace and you can go to types if you want. So you can also have a look inside the namespace. So for example, here we can expand the namespace system and we're gonna have all the types in system. Okay, so it's pretty cool to explore your entire code base this way. Okay, and so you can expand, you can select. One thing pretty cool, you can, for example, if you want to get everything related to collections, so here I just click search. Okay, well that's interesting. Let me change the temp. I'm doing some work on temp. Yeah, let me
put. Oh, okay. Yeah, so easier to see.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, better. The temp is. Oh, that's when you didn't apply. Okay. It should be, okay. Anyway, so here. I did a search for all the stuff related to collections. Okay, and basically it found 3,000 elements with collection that are filtered out because okay. I'm only interested of those ones on the graph itself.
Right.
Okay, and here non-generic collection, system collection, etc. And of course, if I want, I can just keep the results of the search. Okay, and here, I have a view of everything related to collections in the .NET framework. Okay, so it's very quick to realize some kind of view, okay, on the .NET framework itself. So for example, I can expand and then I will get all the types into dictionary, alt-set, list, generic array, etc. So just to show you that with NDPN, you can very quickly demystify a lot of stuff. So imagine you have a large legacy, you can search for where is the customer stuff hidden in the code base, and directly you can have a view, and you can have a view of the dependency itself. Okay, so it was just to demonstrate this kind of thing. One thing I didn't say, and that makes NDPN very apart of all the other tools, is that NDPN, the entire, so there are many features and they are all based on, code querying through C# link query.
Okay. So
basically, for example, here I did a search and actually when I tap collection, what I didn't see, but I can have a look now, is that I can edit a query. A code query has been generated for me. So from element in code element of the .NET framework, because it's what I analyzed, where name like collections select element. And here I have everything related to collections.
So, okay. So you're saying that even though you use the UI to come up with this search, underneath all of this is a link query that is now exposed there in the upper left.
Yeah, absolutely. I just clicked edit query. But for example, I can go back to the search query results, and I can search, for example, for types. Let's say, for example, by complexity. And I want, here I have a cursor. And here a query is edited for me. And there is,
oh, wow.
Because there is a threshold. Okay. And for example, we can see that XML text reader amp is a very complex type. For
sure.
Example, or DTD parser, etc. So here everything is based on code querying. And even the rules, actually, all the rules are based on code querying. Okay. So for example, avoid types with too many methods. So basically it's just a link query, just like code types where methods count greater than 20, for example. And then I can do some refinement in it. And basically all rules are query themselves. And that's interesting because the description, rule description is comment inside the rule itself.
So,
everything is stored as a textual stuff.
Yeah, okay.
So no compilation or no assemblies to deal with, no versioning. It's just text. And then NDPN can compile it on the fly and you can get some result out of it. And you can dig into the result. Oh, that's interesting. And that's the demote effect. Oh, okay, I understand. I'm running the version in development, so that's why it's
not.
So let's go back to
Let's
go back to Visual Studio. Let me check here. So yes, so I know this version is the latest version in production. It's not the debug version, as you can see. There has been some problem. So let's switch from .NET framework to something that hopefully will speak to more to the audience. To a large ASP.NET Core applications.
Okay.
Okay, and here the ASP.NET Core application is a Node Commerce. So it's
quite
a large and famous open source code base. And I like to use it as a test, like test and depend against that, because it typically looks like the code base that our user have.
Okay.
So this is quite a large code base. There are many projects, many classes. I think more than 2,000 classes, some tests, etc. Okay. So suppose you just install NDPN, you just install in Visual Studio, okay, and you open your solution that is Node Commerce. Okay. Here you can see a NDPN tab. So actually it should be an extension because now NDPN, but you can manage extension and make it so it's here. If you prefer, but else you can have it in extension. Here, NDPN is claiming attach a new NDPN project to the current Visual Studio solutions. Okay. So here I want, for example, to build the reports. So here I have all the refreshments. Okay, so another demo effect. So here there are the assemblies and the projects to analyze. And here we can see that the tests are apart, because they are filters test, minus test. Okay, so analyze the assemblies and build the reports. Okay, so here also it will take a few seconds.
So I think you were showing there that NDPN ran the tests for you?
No, sorry, it was not clear. No, the test code is not analyzed.
You're saying don't include the tests. Okay,
yes,
I got it.
Don't include the tests, sorry, it was not clear. And but actually we are very serious about testing. So NDPN is not at all a test runner,
nor a test tool.
But
no, I understand that it wasn't. I guess I was just trying to make sure I understood what you were saying.
Yeah, sure. So it's still analyzing and building the report, but NDPN can import the test coverage results from any tool. Visual Studio, NCrunch, .cover, OpenCover, NCover, etc. So basically, you can get the file you get from all these tools and import into Visual into NDPN. And then, the analysis is just finished. But just to finish on coverage, then you can write code query, for example, 10 methods that have changed and are not covered by test, for example. You can write that sort of query. I will try to demo that later. So here I just finished my first analysis of NoobCommerce, and it saved me what you want to do. Do you want to see the dashboard or the graph we just showed before, or the code rules? Okay, I'll close this dialogue. So I want to show the graph, which is here, the report. So report has just been made for us. Okay, so it's a pure HTML JavaScript report that you can share with the team. So we have the dashboard that we just saw earlier for the .NET framework, basically with all the metrics, the number of lines of code, the number of classes, of types, etc. An estimation of the technical debt. Okay, I will explain that in detail a bit later. Number of issues, okay, number of rule violated, sorry. And something very interesting, also quality gates. Okay, so maybe you are not used to what is a quality gate.
Well, let's go ahead and define it for people that are watching.
Yeah, sure. So basically, a quality gate is contrary to a rules. So basically, a rule is here to put issues. Okay, a rule will find you code smell or bugs or error prone code, etc. inside your code. A quality gate is a different thing. A quality gate is something, it's a criterion, a quality criterion that would put a state. And a state can be three states. It can be pass, run, or fail.
Okay.
Okay, so if it's passing, it's green. If it's running, then you have a problem. And if it's failing, then you cannot release the code or cannot continue. If it's failing,
right.
You need to, something is bad on this code base, and then you need to fix it. Okay?
Right. So most teams should define quality gates to say that, like, after we've built and after we've analyzed our code, you know, if there's anything red, that's a no-go to ship the code.
Exactly.
Teams should define it, but we get these by default in independ. And I'm going to guess, I have a feeling you're going to tell me this answer. I'm going to guess that a team could configure these to fit their needs.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
100%. Why? For two reasons, for several reasons. First, there are a dozen of default quality gates. So basically percentage coverage, but here, remember, we didn't import yet coverage.
Right.
Percentage covered on new code and on refactor code. So this is another very important features of NDPN, is that when you say new code or refactor code, it means against the baseline.
Okay.
Okay, so basically NDPN can take a snapshot of your code base. So typically this is the first analysis results. Okay, and you can say this first analysis results is a baseline. And then I'm going to track the changes from this baseline.
Okay,
so basically,
yeah.
It can define new classes or methods that have been refactored, etc. Okay, and then you can infer some quality gate and even some rules, and I will describe. So that's pretty convenient. So issues with a special severity like blocker or critical or some other issues, critical rules, so some rule can be critical, it means that you want zero issues in this rule.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
Percentage depth, okay, here also. And depth per namespace, okay, new depth since baseline, as I just described. New interest, so not only NDPN can try to estimate the depth in terms of cost to fix. Okay, so basically, depth means that you have problems in your code base,
right.
how much it's gonna cost you to fix it. In terms of
the interest
or in terms of money, because you can say that there is pay hour,
oh, okay.
Human cost me that much, and then you can just do a conversion, and NDPN can do that for you. And also it's trying to assess the interest. So not only the debt, but interest means cost to not fix.
Yeah, right.
Okay, if you let it unfixed, if it's a problem, it means that it costs you to not fix it. The definition. So you try to estimate that, and then you can use the two metrics to do some kind of balance to try to see which problems are the first one to fix. Okay, and so that here I'm presenting the philosophy behind the tool. So as you guessed, everything with as with everything with NDPEN, quality gates are themselves code query. Okay, so let me, that's an interesting graph. So let me have a look about such a code query. So here you have the query and rule explorer. Okay, you can reach it from there. Rule explorer, sorry. Okay, sorry, it's not, so that's funny. Okay, and here you have the quality gates and we can edit the quality gate, just select it. So here you have the description, as explained, it's a textual rule, okay? And here it can be as simple as that. So basically you define a quality gate with a fail warning, a fail threshold, sorry, one threshold, and then you define a code matrix. So basically this is a mini code query. You can have a bigger, let's say bigger blocker issue, for example. So fail if count greater than zero in issue, from E in issue with severity blockers, okay. Select new, and here we have quite a few, 1,000 issues, okay, such issue. Okay, with all details about the technical debt and the interest, etc., of the issue. So here there is a tooltip trying to explain you. So if I select something, you have a lot of details for everything, to dig into the detail for everything. Okay, so here also quality gates. So that means that when you were claiming that quality gates are configurable, as you guess, it's very easy to write your own query or to adapt right. an existing one to define pretty much everything, the threshold and the query tech itself, etc. And it's a sharp link.
So it makes sense to me now why NDPEN. I think we showed at the beginning when you were going to look at this project. That it's a project you add, because it seems that this isn't a tool that you run and then it lives external. You actually have an independent project that knows about your project. Yeah, so exactly. That way you can customize it per project or maybe per team, or you or your organization maybe starts at a certain baseline and then you say, well, for this team, we've got some other critical issues that we want to define. These rules are code. So they have to live with your code base.
Exactly that. You have a project property. So there is an NDPEN project property, very similar to what you have in a Visual Studio project. And here, basically, you define all the projects you want to analyze. Okay, so you remember it's referencing a NOAA commerce solution.
Right.
And I want to filter out tests. Okay, so I'm not interested here in quality of tests. Right. And I want to focus only on a project quality. And that's interesting because you can put, usually on a very large legacy, we have several solutions. So you can reference several solutions and you can spawn your NDPEN project over several solutions. And because NDPEN is very optimized to work with very large legacy, as we can see with .NET 5, with 80,000 classes. Right. So you can really analyze a lot of stuff. So just to give you a sense of this, that's when it's taking time today. So there is around 2,600 type here in this code base, which is not, so this is quite a big website, okay, with tons of refinement and tons of feature. So I presented a lot of stuff. So here, for example, as you can see, you can import the code coverage. Here, the technical debt is computed for you. So let's dig a little bit into how NDPEN does that. So where this number come from? So it says 9% of your code, or you have 9% debt. So what does it mean is that NDPEN estimate the development effort to develop this node commerce. So here you have 2,200.
That was the effort to build it in the first place.
Exactly.
Okay.
And actually, it estimates that the total debt is 204 days.
Yeah. So if
you run like 9%, 10%.
Yeah. Wow. So that, you know, what I like about that is it reminds you that as your code base grows, that, you know, it doesn't take a whole lot of debt to suddenly be in a place where you're looking at a huge effort to resolve it all. So, you know, the rating is B. And again, these things. So I think what'll be interesting to people watching this is, I think as developers, we will naturally say, well, who comes up with these ratings and what meaning do they have and what do they mean for me? But, you know, I bet that most of us on many teams at our jobs, no measurement is being taken. We might go into meetings and talk about our technical debt. And we might say, well, we have a fair amount of technical debt, but it isn't listed anywhere. There's no number behind it that we can measure is going up or down. And even if that number isn't perfect the first day you're using Endepend, even if that measurement isn't absolutely perfect, you have the tool here to teach Endepend over time what you value. And at least you're starting with some number instead of just talking about like, well, I think we have a fair amount of technical debt. What does that mean? Where is
exactly.
it?
Exactly. Yeah, you cannot fix what you cannot measure somehow.
Yeah, okay.
The code need to be measured. That actually Codemetrics, I don't know why, but suddenly I developed a passion for Codemetrics in the early days of Endepend. And I think it's very interesting to get some measurement from code. It's very interesting to try to measure it. So here we have simple measure in terms of line of code and in terms of types, we have some measure estimations, okay? Percentage comment, okay? Number of issues, etc. So that's pretty interesting to measure the code. So here, I don't have coverage data for this project, but I could actually import some coverage data, as I say. And that's pretty interesting because the initial definition of technical debt was the amount of code not covered. Okay,
So
there are some rules about the coverage itself. And so every method not well covered is add up a little bit of debt, okay? So the management, what's interesting is that we find it very carefully. And typically our user, I mean, we get many feedback that it's realistic.
Yeah,
it's quite realistic. And of course, from the project property, you can change everything. So issues and depth, so number of work hour per day, number of work day per year, etc. So I talk about money, like an hour it's 50 USD or 100 USD or whatever. So basically, how you define the debt rating in terms of percentage of debt, okay, etc. So here you can basically you can define everything. But that's interesting, but we didn't, I think we didn't see yet the heart of Endepend is that here, okay, we get some measurement, we can go to meeting, we can talk about numbers, but the thing is that nobody stopped the development for 200 days.
Right.
To solve everything, that's not realistic. That's not realistic, nobody can do that, can afford to do that. Even in the worst nightmare code base. Sometimes what happened, we shut down legacy to rebuild it. That happens, but that costs a lot of frictions, a lot of money, and a lot of pain. So the heart, to me, the heart of Endepend is this baseline system. So what we're gonna do, we're gonna use the analysis we just did as a baseline, and we're gonna try to modify our promise. So let's have a little modification I prepared here. So actually I commented the modification. So let's have, okay, I'm uncommenting it. So what I did here, I introduced a bit of code. So there are two classes. So here we have a base classes that is using a derivative classes, for example.
Okay.
It's very dirty. And we have a very dirty method.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Oh yeah.
So yeah, very dirty method. So let's analyze and see what Endepend will say about that. So let's first recompile. Then let's trigger the analysis. Actually, the analysis could be triggered automatically. It's just a setting. Okay, so it's just compiling, and then the key is that Endepend not only will find that you have new code, but then it will try to estimate the new issues and the new debt on this stuff. And then you can start I think the philosophy is to try to be clean on the new stuff. So, okay, from there, we have this legacy. It's running in production. We know it's not perfect, but we're going to try to improve things. And how do you improve things? You start improving it on the new class you return, on the new method we will be factoring, etc. Okay, so this is the idea. So let's run the analysis. So here I didn't show you. You have a little recap thing like issues and quality gates and everything. So here you can also quickly run an analysis. Okay, so I just compile and run the analysis. Okay, and then on the dashboard is going to be very interesting because all the numbers we already show before. Oh, that's okay. So I just clicked to get the first analysis as the baseline. Okay.
So you clicked you clicked back on the dashboard. Okay. And that's something you had said earlier is just about everything on this dashboard can be clicked into.
Yes. Not only everything, but every diff also you can diff. So and you can detect it. So the first analysis was 16 minutes ago. So this is if I had many, I could just click them.
Yeah.
Okay. And it tells me that I added 57 line of code. Okay, so I can click to see the new code stuff.
Oh, nice.
Indeed, there is the very dirty method. I can double click and immediately go down there.
Yep.
Okay, and you can see when it's in bold, it's the new stuff, and when it's underlined, it's the modified stuff. Okay, so I did the derived class and the base class, etc. Okay, and a field,
etc. So I just very quickly see what changed. Yeah.
Yeah, you can definitely from the baseline what's happening. So the same, you have new types and new methods, et cetera, but I think the most interesting, you can see your diff in terms of depth.
Yep. So it's here, gone up.
Yeah, it's growing up, and because we introduced something so dirty, so it's not surprising it's growing up. We didn't try to fix anything actually, but we just add up dirty stuff. So it's growing up, so that's why it's red. And here we have 5 new issues.
Oh, wow. Look at that. So to your point, you said the best way, or I'm not sure that you said the best way. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but that when you have a big legacy code base, let's try not to add more debt.
Yeah.
And
this
is a great way for you to see right away on a dashboard. Hold on before I do anything. Yeah.
Yeah. That's the only, I think to me, that's the only proper way to tackle the legacy. So not only the new code will be green from now because there are many strict rules he needs to pass. But also, when you start refactoring, there are some rules about refactor code that force you not only to just add a new logic or just modify the logic. No, if you touch a logic, you make it clean. So if you touch a method that is not well tested, then you write test. If you test a method that is too complex, then you split it in several methods or maybe in a few classes, etc. So step by step, not only the new stuff will be clean, but also the stuff you are refactoring is gonna be clean as well. So that's the idea. And with time, in 1 year, 2 years from now, etc. Of course, the portion of green code, code with no or very few issue and code well tested, etc. With time, this portion of code is growing, and then you start getting a legacy. Your legacy is getting better with no major upfront investment. You didn't have to stop for a while, and we stop now, and because nobody wants to do that, no manager accept that. Or usually in the real world, it's very hard to make that accepted by the manager. So that's the idea of such a tool. So here, we introduced some new issue. So let's have a look at the new issue.
Yeah, okay.
So here the issue, they are not grouped. So basically they are just grouped by the code element they are related to. So here we have a base class should not use derivative. Okay, and indeed, so there is this rule, and indeed the base class is using a derivative, which is not really
okay,
nice.
Yeah.
Okay, and we can also double click here, and we can see this is the only issue in this rule. So we can have a description, and if we look at the rule source code, it's very intuitive, like base class, derivative types, used by base class. Okay, and here we have that, and the derivative class is this one.
Okay. Yep.
So one interesting point is that if I go back to the file, something interesting is that there is a query to query the issue itself, and this query is generated for me with comment actually. Okay, so pretty much everything you click within the NDPN is actually a query generator that that will let you dig inside what you really want. Okay.
Yeah. Wow. Even these diff metrics click and there's some code.
Yeah. From E in issue where issue was added.
And yeah,
implicitly was added from against the baseline. It was not in the baseline, but so basically NDPN is taking all the rules and it executes all the rules against the baseline and against the new snapshot, and then it is the diff. So here the diff is only this five issue. And so here you evolved the method potentially commenting. Okay, so we can see that the very dirty method is not the only one, but it's the only one that is bold, which means that it,
yes,
is the only one that is a new issue.
Since the baseline, yeah.
Yeah. Avoid methods too big, too complex. So definitely it's too big, too complex.
Right.
Okay. From which now,
yeah,
all methods should respect basic quality principle. All methods added. So it detected that the redirect method was added.
Okay. Okay.
And it's not respecting the quality principle. And also it's a potentially dead method. Because
yes,
nobody
okay.
called actually a very dirty method. Okay?
No. And, yeah, nobody's called.
So it's still potential because maybe you are using it with reflection, but there are some heuristics to detect that kind of problem. But here it's really a dead method.
So two questions from just this list. And, you know, I don't mean to drill in on this method because this is just an example, but I liked that third one where it says from now all methods added should respect basic quality principles. So it sounds like as a team, we could start using NDPN. And just as you said at the very beginning, we're getting our baseline of what our code base looks like. We've never used this tool before. And then we can say to NDPN, or by default, NDPN is saying, I'm going to help you produce good code from now on.
So,
yeah, because if you put that, you know, warning or error issue throughout your code base, it would just be overwhelming.
Yeah.
So here it's like, hold on, you know, you just wrote some new code. Let's not make it worse.
Yeah, that's exactly that, because actually here I'm on the NDPN.com website.
Okay.
And this is exactly right. So here there are some use cases. So because as you saw, the tool has many features and many use cases. So we try to group the use case. And one of these use cases is write clean code from now on. It's
right.
It's exactly the terminology you just used. And from this page, the user can see, okay, what do I want to do? Do I want to ramp up in a new code base because I don't know the code base? So we saw that it can help improve the architecture. Actually, there are some rules for that. For example, let me go back to Node Commerce. Okay, I can go back to dependency graph. So here I have all the dependency of my project. That's pretty interesting because we can see there is a huge core. Is independent, node core, web services, etc. And then we have satellites of project that depends on the core.
Okay.
So the architecture is very clear from there. Something I didn't explain that you see some colors. So basically, this color tells you that, for example, here.
Oh, okay.
When it's blue, when it's blue, it's used, it's consumed. And when it's green, it's not consumed. So you can very quickly. If I want all colors and Kali, and I can just click that. And here I have all the colors and all the Kali. And that's interesting because actually a code query again has been generated and its results have been exported to graph for me, okay, automatically. So that's pretty interesting. So,
So you're right that that graph, one of the things about that graph that I didn't see the first time when you showed the .NET framework one, is how, and again, this is just looking at it for a few seconds, the arrows tend to be pointing one way, like they're all pointing downhill. They all seem to be going left to right. You mentioned a few moments ago that NoOp Commerce is well known for being a pretty clean architecture. And we can, for the first time, instead of just you saying it, and we have to take your word for it,
yeah,
we can kind of see it.
Yeah.
So that's really neat. And then I'm just going to guess that the larger, how it chooses to whether to make a box larger or smaller is based purely on just the amount of code, methods, classes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Oh, so that could even be changed.
Yeah, sure. If you want constant area, you can have this. Depends on the scenario. Yeah.
Sure. So maybe that might be something like, for instance, constant area. It says, why would I want to do that? Well, maybe this is something you want to put up in a presentation and actually walk over instead of having people ask you, what's that one in the upper left? They're all readable now, but this is the one that lets you visualize how big are these components,
how big are these. And also the thickness of the edge tells you how big is the coupling. So for example, you can double click on edge. So let me double click this edge.
Okay.
And here it shows you the entire coupling. So you can see it's very, very coupled. There is plenty of types from there. So this one in green, the user in coupling graph, and this one in blue are the used. And as you can see, it's very, very highly coupled. And here, this one, of course, it's hard to read. But what's interesting is that here, a code query has been generated when I clicked the edge. And here, I can see that this type is using those ones, this type is using those ones, etc.
Oh, yeah, wow.
I go down. Still, is the magic of code query is that you can really view anything you want in your code base. But if we go back, I can take an edge that is a bit less. So for example, let's take this one. Okay, and here it's a much more understandable graph.
Okay.
Because the edge was less thick, so I knew that there were less coupling between these two projects. But then I can immediately see the project coupling, which is pretty cool. I can also have a change map. So basically I can just show the graph of the change. So I have the base class, I added the derivative class and the so it's very simplistic graph. So here also code query has been generated, which is from the search code was changed or was added. So code query is there for me, and then it's exported to the graph. And something very cool is the cycle graph. If you want to dig into the architecture, so here this is actually a rule, so it's editing a rule. By the way, a rule is a code query with the one if count prefix. So this is not C-sharp. Okay.
Right.
One if count is not C-sharp, but then just after that it's C-sharp. But it just says instead of being a query that generates match, it's a rule that generates issues. Basically, this is a way to say that to independent.
Yeah, so the query itself is C-sharp, but then you've got, it's kind of like a predicate language that says, okay, now that you've run the query, based on the result, decide whether this is an issue to bring up. Another one I wanted to look at, the potentially dead methods one, and it's not because of anything special about dead methods. It reminds me of things like FXCop or StyleCop, where developers, I think, often when they see a warning or a rule that they know they're not going to address, you said it yourself, the potentially dead method might be called by reflection, maybe. And let's say as developers, we are sure, we're certain that that method is called by reflection. Would we do something in end-depend to turn it off for that instance?
Suppress message. You can use exactly the same way you are using with FXCop or Mozilla Analyzer. You have the suppress attribute. Yes.
Exactly. Okay. And now, what do you, I want to ask, so you can suppress it maybe with a comment or something, but I want to ask you, what do you think about that? Do you think developers are too quick to suppress a warning and it's too easy to say, well, and now you've forgotten about it. So what approach do you like for making those kinds of decisions where you're going to override this tool that's trying to help you?
Yeah, exactly. So here, let me edit the rule, which is potentially dead methods.
Okay.
So we can have a look at the code, which is interesting. There is a lot of heuristic that if it's serializable, etc. So there is a massive heuristic to try to avoid false positive. This is very important to avoid false positive, because then you are instead of gaining time to developer, you make them lose time, which is not what you want. But suppose we know that very dirty method is definitely a call method by reflection. You just click suppress issue, and for you, and depends.
Okay, an attribute, code. Yeah.
So I can copy that to the app, and then I just have to upload, and then I just have to suppress the message here.
Right.
Then the next time it's passing, there is a problem with namespace anyway. But then the next time it's analyzing, then you won't be wrong about this issue anymore, which is pretty interesting. But actually, what do I think about that? I think that putting some that kind of attribute in the code is very interesting, very good, because you are showing some intent. So you are capturing some intent in the code itself. So typically, the guys that did the very dirty method is calling it by reflection, but maybe his colleague doesn't know that.
Okay.
So now they have this attribute with a nice comment. It's not a mystery anymore. So suddenly the code is getting more. What one I like especially is we propose an attribute which is named full covered attribute. Okay, you suppose you're coding a class, you write some test to cover it 100%. Okay, what you want is that even when it's gonna be refactored, this class remain 100% covered. Okay, because that's the initial intention. You want to be very testable. That's very important to make it testable. And then you just put a full covered attribute, and then there is a rule in the coverage category that claim if a class is tagged with full covered, but is actually not 100% covered, then you have an issue.
Okay, so that's nice. That's like an affirmative rule where earlier we suppressed something that the tool was trying to tell us. Now we can express our intent that we want code to meet even different bars, different standards.
Yeah, and it's very easy to define your own attribute and your own rule this way. Maybe something I didn't make it clear from the beginning is that NDPend is not really, doesn't really compete with Rosin Analyzer or Wishapper or whatever. That's great because those are marvelous tools. So the idea is not to reinvent the wheel because first, as you can see since the beginning, everything is based on code query. So everything is very easy to modify and adapt. Okay. But also NDPend is more about the high level. So inside the code model that is presenting through the link query, you have a lot of stuff already defined, like the code metrics, number of comments, number of line of code, or percentage coverage ratio, or diff since the baseline, is it a new method, etc. So everything is also already hardwired into this language. And so instead of trying to do the kind of rule Roslyn does, like in the code flow, this reference can be null, for example. Typically, Sharper is catching very well also this kind of problem. Or in this switch statement, you are missing this value, etc. And depend is not so much about this fine-grained rule, but it's more about coarse-grained rule. Okay. So just to go quickly through default categories, so cut smell, so tips to bad, tips to big, etc. Cut smell regression, so typically from now on, we saw this method, from now all method added should respect basic quality principle, and we have very dirty method. So here, the regression is cut smell, but against the baseline. So basically,
it's
rule restraint only on the delta. And that's pretty interesting. So object oriented, like interface too big, base class should not use derivative that we already saw, or do not hide base class method, or etc. Singleton pattern, some more design rule about disposable pattern, etc. Empty static constructor, etc. Some architecture rule. So I was about to show you that from the graph. So just let me show you. So in the graph, you can click this cycle here. And actually, it's editing the avoid namespace dependency cycle rule that is here. Okay, so that's the same rule. And that's interesting because then you can export this cycle to the graph. So here I can export. So inside NoOp services and assemblies, I have 30 namespace in a big ball of mud.
Yeah, sure.
And
that's not as clean as that pretty graph we saw earlier. It's going back and forth. Yeah.
Yeah. That's inside. That's inside the big box that is NoOp services. And actually, when I'm overing any namespace here, I can see that there is a big ball of mud. So typically, how do I want to fix that? So what you want here is a layered component with high level, low level. It's not at all like high level because everything is depending on everything. So basically, the first thing to do is to avoid the red arrow, which means mutually dependent. And you remember when you double click, you can have a look. So those ones are using those ones. And so you don't want that this blue is using this green.
Yeah, right.
Because typically, the NoOp service orders is a higher level than the common PDF services. So PDF services shouldn't use the order. But actually, this is summarized into a rule itself. Okay, so typically, this rule attempts to find all the dependency, mutual dependency between your component, between your namespace, and tells you that this class or this method shouldn't use this method because namespace shouldn't use this namespace. Okay, so you have a rule for that. And for each issue, it's trying to estimate that it's going to cost you 15 minutes or maybe more. So that there is some heuristic to try to 20 minutes, or there is some heuristic to try to estimate what it's going to cost you to make sure that this big ball of mud is now a clean layer of code. So this is what the architecture rules are all about. You can also have some custom rules like UE layer shouldn't use directly the DB layer, etc. Okay, so you have some interesting rule. You have some API breaking change, which is, so here there is no problem. So typically API breaking change is because I have a baseline, I can detect what used to be public and is not public anymore. So if I publish a framework and I have clients that are using public class, if it's not public anymore, then you're breaking your client. And this is what rules such as API breaking change are all about. Okay, then you have the code coverage rule, like the code should be tested, but here you need to import some code coverage data. Okay, so we don't have this, but it's all about the coverage I tell you before. Dead code rule, we already potentially dead method. So typically method you want to inspect that because they are not called at all. Okay, some security rule. Okay, some visibility rules like this internal method could be declared as private because it's not used anywhere except within this class. Some rule about immutability, which are very interesting, like a structure should be immutable, for example. This is becoming very relevant today with the new C# 9 recall.
Okay, yeah,
that
right.
is designed to make some kind of classes that looks like struct, and that typically should be immutable. So you even have rules that tell you if a record class is not immutable, it's immutable, which is very bad.
Oh, cool. Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah, some naming convention like interface should become with an I. Or here the rules source code is very easy. You just detect which types is an interface, and then you look at the name. You do some string pattern on the name of the class, which is pretty cool. Some source file organization, like you should have one types per source file, etc. Or if you duplicate a type definition across several projects, for example. Dotted framework usage, so typically collections, threading, XML, etc. API usage, so for now we only focused on Unity because Independ can analyze some large .NET Unity project, which is very interesting. And then, so that was all the rule sets. And then here you have the just my code stuff. So we had this discussion about the suppressed message. Okay, and just my code is here to prevent to have some false positive on generated code. So here you have some special code query that are predefined with not my code. Okay, so if you predefine with not my code, it means that this query is matching some generated code, generated with ASP.NET designer or WinForm designer or XAML designer, etc. So typically on this code, the rules are not emitting some issues. Okay,
yeah, okay.
And why? Because if you look at the for example, because most rules are using the domain just my code.
Yeah, I remember seeing that earlier.
Yeah, and so instead of application, you can either use application or just my code. You can also use the third party if you want to know about what you are using. So that's how NDPN can detect the API usage, because NDPN also knows about the API you are using. So actually, if we go back to dashboard, it can tell you that this node commerce is using around 4,000 third party elements. So you can have a look at that. So third party element, as a convention, they are blue. Okay, and we can see everything that is really used by your application. Then you can start writing some rule about that, or doing some queries. So that's pretty interesting to really see the API your application is consuming. Okay, and so that was about the just my code stuff. And then there is also this trend metric stuff. So here you can plot over time some trend metrics graph or chart, sorry, better say chart. And so you can define some code metrics. So around 174 code metrics are defined for you, and you can start plotting them into some charts. And the charts,
yeah.
You can see them in a, so you can plot the number of issues, the number of rules violated, the number of quality gate violated, etc. The technical depth, etc. And then with this trend chart, we can start to see if the trending is better, is getting better or worse with time.
Right.
So it's pretty pretty interesting. I can show you on NDPN itself what this does look like. So here I have NDPN inside Visual Studio. So the code base. So this is another cool panel I'm gonna quickly mention first. So if I go back to the dashboard of NDPN. Okay, since many years we've plotted, and we can see the number of lines of code growing, but we can also see in green the percentage coverage, the number of lines covered. So here it's 84% coverage, which is pretty cool. Okay, and I can see the coverage growing and the number of lines of code growing. So over time it's pretty cool. And this one, this is the code metric view, another view I didn't detail. So if you import code coverage here, you can see what is well covered or not. So basically, this is tree map based on line of code. Those rectangles are methods. And when a method is green, it means that it's covered by test. And when it's red, it's not covered by test.
Then right.
Just the color. And then that's pretty interesting to use this tool to start inspecting, to get a totally different view of your code base in terms of where is it well covered. And for example, here I can see that it needs more coverage, and here also definitely more coverage. Okay. So you can definitely have a more visual view of your code, which is pretty cool. Another panel I didn't show, so let's go back to node commerce. Another panel I didn't show earlier is the dependency matrix. So the same way you have some graph. That's interesting why it's not. I think that there is a problem because of the zoom, because this, I have two screens and this one is in high DPI and it's provoking some, since the beginning I see some empty panel and it's provoking some, yes, okay. It's provoking some problems. So I think there is an interaction between the mixed multi DPI DPI monitor and the zoom recording also.
Right.
That's okay, now we have the matrix. So here, instead of having a graph, you can also view the things with a matrix. So for example, and here you have the assembly use. So for example, if I want to have a loop, so we can see that this assembly sending blue is using text regular expression. And if I want to have a look at what's happening, I can see exactly that those methods actually are using these replace methods. So I can very quickly go to a fine-grained view. So sometimes the matrix can be better suited than the graph. It really depends on the scenario you have, but I really enjoy the exploring code with matrix. So typically this view, so I can, for example, I can export that to the matrix. Okay. So this view basically is the same as the other view, as the dependency graph. You just get a bit of.
Right, but now you're just looking at it a different way and getting actual numbers instead of the line thickness and things like that.
Exactly. So, and here because it's a whole mess, there is a big red square that tells me that, hey, this is entangled. You can even have an indirect dependency mode. That's so everything is black, which means that everything depends. So, for example, here, these two ones are involved into a cycle. Okay, and if I click over it, I get a cycle into how they are implied. So it's really a mix of, as you can see, there are many use cases, as I mentioned earlier, about architecture stuff, getting started with a code base, a code issue, technical debt, reporting, quality gates. Okay, so as explained in the, here, you have an introduction to the independent use case into the documentation. Then you can start having a look. We also have a lot of video. Okay, so here, I need to refresh the cache. So here we have a lot of video.
Yeah, look at that.
If you want to get started. So it's very short and concise and straight to the point. So you're not gonna lose your time watching this video. That's interesting.
Right.
A lot of documentation. Something I didn't show earlier, so I showed the report, so you can have NDPN as a reporting tool. You can also have NDPN as an Azure DevOps extension. So you have a whole bunch of documentation and video to explain that. And then comparing to the licensing, you have the developer mode, build machine, and Azure DevOps or TFS extension.
Okay, so NDPN, instead of just using it on my machine, you've already got documentation and thought about different CI/CD. Yeah. So, because you figure that's what organizations are going to want to do is say, let's see how we did over the last week. How did we go from commit to commit? Things like that.
Yeah, it's really up to you. The way, of course, the graph and everything, you need a developer license to get it on your machine, to use it inside or outside Visual Studio. But then you can use any CI/CD technology. TeamSeek, there are documentation for Azure DevOps, of course. TeamCity, Jenkins, Bamboo, Avdeo. You can also import the NDPN issues into SonarQube if you already
have
SonarQube.
Yep.
Cruise control, even on Final Reader, or even earlier version of TFS. So really, you can use the tool in pretty much all those environment. And now we're also planning to work on the GitHub Actions. So you're gonna have a new server side that will look like the actual TF Azure DevOps extension. And those will be seen as a server. And then you can jump from the GitHub to your server and get all the data you want. So that will be pretty cool.
I can't wait to see that. Can't wait to see that integration with GitHub Actions too, as more and more projects are purely, I mean, they do everything on GitHub. So, you know, they at least, it's not that you probably today, it's not that an open source team couldn't use this. It's just that what you're trying to help them with is your home is GitHub. Let's help you stay in GitHub as long as you can.
Yeah, and with the new code space, that's interesting what Microsoft is doing, like adding your ID into your browser. So,
yep.
Yeah.
Directly from a repo. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We've talked about that on the show a couple times. It's one of my favorite upcoming, you know, features is seeing more and more of these online code.
Yeah,
it's not just code spaces. More and more, you know, different types of in your browser tooling. So all of this is at ndpn.com. I was really impressed by how you showed just how just about every metric, everything you could click on, came back to actual, you know, a code-based query. And then you think about the thousands of them that are running, and maybe thousands isn't even the right order of magnitude. It could be much higher than that for a code base that you showed. And yet we didn't sit here that long waiting around for things. You know, dashboards were up before you were ready to move on to the next topic. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah, thank you. And if you want to play with it, there is a 14-day trial that can be extended actually. And yeah, you can play with the tool with all the features and then see if it suits you, how does it work on your code base. Typically, if you look at the page getting started, you can start having some results into a few minutes. Okay, there is a very short video that explains you how to get started, how to install, etc. That can be that can be very quickly. And yeah, I think to me, when I started doing NDPen, it's really a tool I always wanted. I've been ramping up into many, many code base, many legacy, as every consultant. I used to be a consultant. And I was always frustrated that why do I have to go to all the code, because it's just not scalable. Like if you have thousands of file, source file, why do I have to go? How do I know what this one means? Like, I want 100,000 view, and then I want a tool that lets me precisely go in detail to what I want to see.
And yeah,
that was one of the original ideas for the tool.
Yeah, especially like you said, if you're, you know, you said as a consultant, you're constantly looking at brand new code bases that have years, I mean, years of work behind them, and there aren't always people there. I think I said it at the beginning, we don't know if the same developers are there. How are you going to get information about it? So you get it very quickly, which is pretty cool. And, you know, there was a lot more to this than I realized. Like I said, I think I had told you, you'd asked me, what did I know about NDPen? And I said, well, I know what I've read on the website. And this got me thinking a lot. And I hope that the audience too got thinking a lot about the metrics that we probably aren't measuring in our code bases today, but we should be, to get an idea of our situation. So I definitely want to thank you, Patrick. This is great. And I hope that everybody watching enjoyed it and got a good idea of not only, you know, some good practices for code and architecture that we draw it on a whiteboard, but this is saying, here's what your code's actually doing. Forget what you thought it was doing. And that we probably need to be spending more time doing that. So I really do appreciate that.
Thanks for the opportunity to present. And yeah.